This episode is brought to you by Wondrium.
London, England. While many of us today may see it as a quaint, old-timey city or a potential future vacation destination, there was a time where you wouldn't have wanted to step near the city proper.
Because of all the smog? I know that there was so much pollution there during the Industrial Revolution.
Well, not quite. See, in the 19th century, London was famed as the capital of the largest empire on Earth, and a truly disgusting place to live. Mud and filth caked the streets, sooty smog choked the air, and sewage was dumped straight into the Thames River. In fact, the Thames was so notoriously gross that one hot summer day in 1858, the smell from it alone forced politicians to vacate their buildings in an event known as the Great Stink. And unfortunately for everyone, water companies also used the Thames River to bottle water and sell it. But in the midst of all this filth, how exactly did a used diaper cause a local pandemic? And more importantly, how did beer save a building full of workers from it? Today's episode deals with a widespread and fatal disease, and may include descriptions of the symptoms, causes, and effects of it. Viewer discretion is advised. And with that out of the way, let's get into it. Before we get into the 1858 cholera outbreak, what exactly is cholera, and how does it spread? Well, according to the Center for Disease Control, cholera is an acute diarrheal illness caused by infection of the intestine with the toxigenic bacterium Vibrio cholerae serogroup 01 or 0139. An estimated 2.9 million cases and 95,000 deaths occur each year around the world. The infection is often mild or without symptoms, but can be severe. If severe symptoms should arise, then cholera can prove fatal within a few short hours. And the way it goes is unpleasant, to say the very least. Cholera causes infected individuals to become dehydrated through the uncontrollable evacuation of their bodily fluids, shall we say. The proper treatment for cholera is rehydration. Not just drinking water, mind you, but specific rehydration solution that has a balanced level of water, electrolytes, and sugar.
So the cure is some sports drink?
Close enough.
Or products such as Pedialyte. Though the World Health Organization has a specific drink called the New Oral Rehydration Solution. In particularly severe cases, patients may need intravenous fluid replacement. Thankfully, with quick and proper treatment, the CDC reports that less than 1% of cholera cases prove fatal. But that's with modern technology. Let's take a step back into the leading medical minds of the early 1800s. For centuries, it has been understood that disease is caused and spread via the dreaded miasma, a fancy word which here means an oppressive or unpleasant atmosphere which surrounds or emanates from something.
Oh, miasma! That's like concentrated bad vibes, right?
Yeah, kind of. This miasma was released from filth and decay, with the resulting foul odors or smells causing the spread of disease.
Fun fact, miasma theory is actually why plague doctors have their distinctive bird beak masks. They would fill the beak full of dried flowers, herbs, and spices to counteract the bad air.
Belief in miasma was quite attractive to English sanitary reformers, since it explained why epidemics broke out so often among the poor, filthy, unwashed masses. There were other theories on how disease was spread, of course, like blood generation theory, which stated that disease was spontaneously created in blood, and germ theory, which stated that organisms too small for the human eye to see were responsible for the spread of disease. Germ theory grew in popularity after the invention of the microscope in 1676, and the mind-blowing revelation that a small world existed in even a drop of water. But even by the 1800s, there were many that held fast to the conventional wisdom of miasma being the origin of disease. Remember the Great Courses Plus? I'm thrilled to talk to you about their biggest development yet. They've been working hard to bring you more mind-blowing educational content than ever before. Welcome to Wondrium. Wondrium is a place for minds that wonder. They have a massive catalog, over 6,000 hours, of videos on everything, from tutorials and how-tos to documentaries and travelogues, all academically researched, endlessly entertaining, and hosted by engaged and excited experts.
I was ecstatic to see Paul Delon's series, Notorious London, A City Tour, has an episode on the Great Stink of 1858. I learned that from 1715 to 1815, in just 100 years, the population of London more than doubled, from 630,000 to 1.4 million. What's more, around the time of the Great Stink, only 35 years later, the population more than doubled again, up to 3.2 million people. That's way too many people. Gugh. If you've ever sat up at night and wondered about anything, Wondrium will become your new favorite place. To get a free trial, go to wondrium.com/brew or click the link in the description below. Now back to our story. Enter Jon Snow.
You know nothing, Jon Snow.
No, oh, not that one. That's a stale joke even for me.
She is our queen.
It still hurts. Dr. Jon Snow was born on March 15th, 1813, in York, England, as the eldest of nine children to a laborer in a coal yard. At age 14, he left school to pursue three separate medical apprenticeships in Yorkshire and soon had his first encounter with cholera when visiting coal miners in 1831. Throughout his career, Snow would learn to be a master anesthesiologist, to the point where Queen Victoria herself entrusted him with the administration of chloroform during the birth of Prince Leopold in 1853 and Princess Beatrice in 1857. More importantly to this tale, he was a proponent of germ theory, and he was a co-founder of the London Epidemiological Society in 1850. Snow had recently investigated another epidemic and published a much-ignored paper, citing contaminated water as the source of cholera outbreaks. One of Snow's great works came in 1854, when cholera gripped the region of Soho within London. Within days, there were over 127 fatalities around Broad Street. Shortly after that, the body count rose to over 500. Within a week, the only people who hadn't left were the poor and the dead. By a stroke of luck, Dr. Snow lived nearby and began patrolling the region from day one. This was the result of his grand experiment, as it is known today, in which he mapped out instances of cholera and cross-referenced homes suffering the disease to companies supplying contaminated water. Using his experience in epidemiology, he quickly deduced that the culprit was a hand pump that many victims had gathered drinking water from or lived close to leading up to the outbreak. Though, there were some exceptions. Among them, the Broad Street Brewery, which boasted zero cases among its 70 workers. There were exceptions in the opposite direction too, like Susanna Ely and her niece, two women who lived quite a distance from the Broad Street pump yet died of cholera anyways. Traveling to their estate, Snow interviewed her son and learned that not only had Ely once lived around Broad Street, but she had enjoyed the taste of the water there so much, she sent a servant to collect water from the pump every day. While Snow had not managed to prove that cholera wasn't transmitted through miasma, he was certain that the pump had been infected. He brought his case to the local authorities and had them remove the Broad Street pump's handle to prevent others from collecting water from the contaminated supply, and cases immediately began to drop. But what had caused the outbreak of cholera in the first place? And how did those workers manage to evade it? Any guesses?
They had good enough vibes to ward off the bad feels.
What kind of business did you say this was?
It was a brewery.
Let me guess. They didn't drink the water. They drank all the booze.
That's exactly right, actually. The workers at the brewery didn't drink the contaminated water because they were all drinking beer, specifically the beer that they were brewing, as management gave the troops a free allowance on the stuff. But the investigation didn't end there. At first, it seemed as though the well could not have been contaminated by sewage. A cursory inspection found no leakage in the brick lining of the well, and the sewer was 10 feet away and dug deeper into the earth. Reverend Henry Whitehead, a priest who had also responded to the outbreak and consoled those struck by the disease, joined Jon Snow on the medical committee of the General Board of Health in searching for the cause. Though Whitehead disagreed with Snow's conclusions, Whitehead spoke to families four or five times each to confirm the facts and found himself reluctantly concluding that the cause was, in fact, the water pump. And while reviewing the facts, he found out what may have been patient zero. A young child, still in diapers, had died of cholera symptoms days after the outbreak on Broad Street. Whitehead elected to interview the mother and learned that she had been washing the baby's dirty diapers in a pail and dumping the water into a cesspit, directly in front of the Broad Street pump that happened to have a leak in it. Whitehead and Snow had found their culprit.
So the workers avoided the disease because they weren't drinking the water and the outbreak was caused by a poorly made test pit?
But this snow guy, I'm sure he lived a long, cushy life after solving a big pandemic like this. Seems like the kind of thing a doctor would get a reputation from.
Well, he might have, but he unfortunately passed away from a stroke in 1858, only 4 years after the cholera outbreak. But for his work, Snow has since become known as the father of modern epidemiology. And as for beer, well, you'd be surprised at the history it has with humanity. It's a lot to drink in.